French forces retreat northward. But the Germans have encircled France and are invading from the northwest, looting and burning homes along the way. Their objective is a triumphant entry into Paris, the French capital. People flee the city or go into hiding. The streets are deserted. The French generals with their British allies must halt the German advance outside the city or lose Paris and the war. They decide to risk everything and mount a counteroffensive. There is a garrison in Paris, recently reinforced by troops from the French colonies in North Africa. There are few immediate means of transporting them to the battlefield.
Yeah. Because you don't call, you don't number your wars on the first war, because you're opening them up.
Transport the troops in their taxi cabs.
Yeah, this was known as the Great War. Still, in most circles, I think it still is.
Some 25 miles from Paris. After fierce fighting, French and British forces stopped the German advance. Enemy troops are in retreat. The Allies call this battle the Miracle of the Marne. After the Marne, the conflict gets bigger. To further its territorial ambitions in the Far East, Japan gets into the war on the side of the Allies. In the month of October, Turkey joins the Central Powers. The war spreads to the Falkland Islands in South America, and to Africa, and to Asia. Shortly after the Battle of the Marne, the warring armies reach a stalemate. To hold their ground and to protect themselves from enemy fire, both sides settle into pit-like trenches they dig in the earth. No one planned remote trench warfare. Yet before the war's end, trenches stretch from the Swiss border to the English Channel. This is the Western Front. Sometimes reinforced by stacking sandbags. Boredom weighs heavily on the long stretches between spurts of fighting. Because it is difficult to keep clean, men get lice, bugs, roaches infest the meager food supplies. There is no shelter from sleet and snow and pouring rain. When they flood, men get trench foot, a condition of the feet something like frostbite. From standing in water for days on end. Thus they wait, comrades fall, waiting for the dreaded war to attack. Some comrades are shell-shocked, their minds gone under the stress of battle. Some comrades are wounded, some are dead. Still, the order comes, attack. Only them can leave you for treacherous. It's called going over the top. Scrambling over the parapet and attacking with fixed bayonets and in trenches. At times they're mowed down by machine guns. At times they get close enough before firing to see the enemy's faces. For 4 long years, they tussle this way, back and forth for 50 yards of scorched earth. Comes to be called no man's land. Trench warfare drains the manpower of Germany, of France, and of Britain. On the Western Front, men are killed in action at the rate of 5,000 a day. Most Europeans believe that the war would be over by Christmas of 1914. They do not realize that the war had just begun. On both sides, the men in the trenches are homesick. In London, the British government holds a war council. The stalemate on the Western Front must be broken. But how? First, Sea Lord Winston Churchill endorses a plan to assault the Central Powers through the back door, and not Turkey out of the war. It will be a crippling blow to Germany's war effort, while making the best use of Britain's powerful navy. And so, on the other side of Europe, a naval offensive is launched by a fleet of British veteran ships. Orders are to seize the Turkish Dardanelles, a narrow water route between the Aegean Sea and the ports of the Black Sea, through which France and Britain can resupply the crumbling army of their ally, Russia. But the Dardanelles are closed to Allied ships and heavily guarded. From forts high above the straits, Turkish soldiers bombard the invading fleet. After several ships are sunk, the Allies fall to offensive. To Churchill, it's clear the Dardanelles cannot be taken by sea until land forces drive the Turkish army from the Gallipoli Peninsula. Australian and New Zealand troops are drawn into the war to help invade Gallipoli. 50,000 men are killed on the first day of landing. Still, they advance, gaining control. They spend fully 8 months under heavy bombardment trying to push the Turkish army off the peninsula. They're stopped finally by heavy artillery. The cause is hopeless. The Allies retreat. Have they succeeded? The war might have ended in 1915.
I would have went around behind them and cut off their feet.
Italy, not to be left out of the European land grab, declares war on Austria-Hungary. Italians regard Austria-Hungary as the oppressor of the Italian people. For them, the war offers a chance to get back the northern Italian-speaking provinces they had lost. Most of the battles occurred in the Austrian-Italy frontier. Bulgaria gets into the war on the side of the Central Powers. Now, Romania, with a long history of bickering with Austria-Hungary, gets into the war on the side of the Allies. In America, an ocean away from Europe's agony, Woodrow Wilson wins the second term as President of the United States.
One popsicle left. Let's have a sail now. Then look for more. No more. Leave our baby alone. Love is not coming yet.
Germans are first to use it, releasing chlorine gas from canisters and relying on the wind to blow the poisonous cloud. There, the British use gas. Mustard gas is the most deadly. By the end of the war, thousands of men have been killed or hurt by poison gas. Aircraft is in the forefront of the new weapons. At the outbreak of the war,